The views and opinions expressed on this program are not necessarily those of this station, JVC Broadcasting Management, or its sponsors.
Hi, I'm Karen Signoracci. For over 20 years, I've devoted my career to helping nonprofits reach their goals, increase their funding, broaden their donor base, and their community outreach. In addition, I work with my nonprofit clients to get the right people around the table to serve and execute the mission of the organization for its betterment and its service to the community. If you're considering starting a nonprofit, serve on a nonprofit board of directors, or are currently struggling to get your organization to the next level, please visit KarenSCS.com. That's KarenSCS.com. Let me know how I can help you increase your efficiency. One of the key components to a successful nonprofit are its board of directors. They are integral to the success by setting strategy, vision, and taking on fiduciary responsibility. Making key decisions is also part of this role. Please visit KarenSCS.com. That's KarenSCS.com. And let's speak about making your nonprofit and your vision. Hello, hello, and welcome. This is The Big Picture on 103.9 Long Island News Radio. I am your host, Karen Signoracci. I've spent the last 20 years working with nonprofit organizations, raising money, board development, community outreach. And my PSA, as I like to start the show, is I hope you'll hear something today. And you'll be inspired. And you'll think about what you can do in your own community, your block, your place of work, your whatever the case may be, a group that you're involved in, and you'll think about how you could give back. And giving back isn't just money, it's time. And sometimes it's books, sometimes it's for a backpack drive, sometimes it's for a food pantry. And we're going to talk about a couple of different things today, and we have something that we can share that you could get involved in potentially too. But just think about what you can do. There's so much good work being done here on Long Island. So we're going to just put aside the negative stuff you might see on the news and focus on the positive. And that's what we're here to do. Today, I have an outstanding guest. She's a dynamic woman. She's a leader. She's an absolute pleasure to know. Jennifer Cona, welcome.
It's a pleasure to be with you.
Wonderful. We're going to talk about all the things that Jennifer does, including her, you know, her law practice and her work with Senior Dreams, a nonprofit. But tell us, before we get started, you know, we have to talk about food and wine here, as I like quickly snuck in a granola bar this morning. But have you eaten anywhere recently or made anything that you care to share?
I ate at Pierre's in Bridgehampton this weekend. Ooh. It was lovely. Ate outside. It was such a lovely evening. The food was great. I was with good company. It was quite nice.
Okay, so a local spot. Mm-hmm. We like to support local restaurants too.
Yeah.
Pierre's and Bridgehampton.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, I can just counter that with not as out east as far, but I went to a place called in Belmore called the Clubhouse, and it's literally down a side street. You like are in a neighborhood and you turn down this side street and there's the Clubhouse. And it has like a buoy bar / on the water, on the dock kind of vibe, but it was terrific.
Sounds great.
All right. Okay, so you heard two potential local spots here. We got the food and the wine out of the way, one of our favorite topics here on The Big Picture besides nonprofits. So tell us a little about your background and your profession and how you got here.
Sure. Okay. So I'm an elder law attorney. My law firm is Cona Elder Law. I founded it approximately 25 years ago. So we just celebrated our 25th anniversary of being in practice. We're located in Melville and also Port Jefferson Station. We're about 35 people total, and all we do is elder law and estate planning, and everything that goes with that. We have a very dedicated and devoted clientele, and new clients all the time, and we take care of people the way we do our family members. So when we're analyzing cases, we ask ourselves, what would we do if this were my parent, or if this were my sibling, or whatever the case may be? And that's how we treat everyone who comes through our office and how we treat all of our employees and staff members. And that goes a long way for our core values and just our entire culture. And also a key piece to what we value in my law firm is community involvement and give back. So we're involved in a number of nonprofits. And some years ago, about 2007, we founded Senior Dreams Come True, which is, I know what we're going to talk about today. But we were really dedicated to taking care of people and the community in the best way possible, and that is so important to us as we practice elder law and estate planning and guardianships and Medicaid applications and asset protection planning and all the things that we do for clients. We do to the best of our ability, obviously, and with cutting-edge solutions. So we're always looking to move the bar, move the needle, make sure that we're really doing creative solutions for people so that we can make sure we're getting the absolute best outcomes for everybody.
So I sense that you deal with people at a very difficult emotional time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not transactional.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's a relationship.
It's a relationship. It's also multi-generational. We're taking care of families at all kinds of generational levels because the planning and the crisis planning we may do when they're in difficult situations affects not just the people or the person in front of us, but it goes on down the line for generations.
That's so interesting, because when I think about philanthropy and when I think about some of the work that I've done with clients on you know, major gifts and planned giving, it's the same thing.
Absolutely.
It goes down the generation.
Mm-hmm.
It travels through the family. It's a legacy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's emotional.
Yeah.
And it's emotional. And so you're hand-holding,
mm-hmm.
But you're an expert.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to play that fine, you know, that fine role of being sensitive and being caring, of course, but yet I'm an expert and I need you to trust my
yes.
advice and my counsel. And I'm sure that you realized that, you only have one chance with your own parents and your siblings and you want to really do the right thing, especially as they're getting older.
Absolutely. And that's a really good point, that because sometimes people come in with preconceived notions of what they want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe they learn something from what their neighbor did
sure.
or somebody else, and that may not be the best solution for them.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes we have to be very judicious and gentle with saying, that is not the best solution for you, and you have to trust me because,
mm-hmm.
you know, we are the experts. We do know what is best for people, and we have to sort of disabuse them of whatever notion they came in with, but be really sensitive to why they think that. But we do, at the end of the day, have to do what is best for them. But it's all about education.
Education.
We just have to educate them as to why it is that they should do what they should do. But to your point, they only have one crack at it, and they have to get it right. Which also is why it's so important that people get the best advice, that they don't go to someone who is dabbling in elder law or just became an elder law attorney because real estate didn't work out for them or whatever the case may be. People need to go to someone who's been practicing in this area for a long time and knows what they're doing, because you don't want to blow it when you only have one chance. And we do end up doing a lot of cleanup work from other attorneys. And that's not a position anybody wants to be in.
Well, so for you, there's probably changes that you need to keep your team up to date on.
Mm-hmm. All the time.
There's probably classes and clinics and workshops and seminars that you can offer to educate.
Yep.
And then we have to kind of get people to, I think about this in terms of medicine, Dr. Google is not the best answer when you have a stomach ache or this, that, the other. And it's the same thing when you're dealing with legal issues and your mom and your nephew or your sibling or whatever the case may be. Google JD is not going to be the solution. And so you have to come to someone that has experience and is trusted. And I'm sure you have a list of families that hug you at the end of your meetings.
Yes.
Or when they walk in the office, they give you a big hug.
Absolutely.
You've gained that trust.
Yeah, for sure.
And there's a lot of empathy in what you do.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I can also draw the line to fundraising and raising money too. You know, you have to sit in someone's seat and say, I'm sitting here thinking this is, you know, what they might want to hear if they're going to make a large gift or support this endeavor. And you might have to say, I have to sit in their seat and think, this is their mother, and how would I feel if I was in that place? And it takes practice.
Yes. Well, and the thing about elder law and estate planning is that it applies to all of us personally as well as professionally.
Sure.
And we've all gone through these issues with our own families, so we can identify with everybody sitting in front of us. Even when it comes to estate litigation, let's say. We've got families fighting. It appears to be over money, let's say, but it's really probably over emotional issues from childhood, someone thinks mom loved the sister better or whatever the case may be from early childhood, we can all identify with that. We may have all experienced that. And that's what makes it so, honestly, very rewarding in what we do, because it probably was us at some point. You know, we've all done planning, at least in my office. All of our attorneys have done planning for our own family members, so we know exactly what this is all about.
And so in some ways, you wouldn't ask anybody to do something they weren't willing to do themselves.
That's right.
That's right. And that we tie that back into the nonprofit world and ask people for money and donating their time. So can you give us the website?
Sure. It's conaelderlaw.com, C-O-N-A-E-L-D-E-R. .com.
Great. So I have Jennifer Cona here. We're going to talk about senior dreams. But come right back. This is 103.9 Long Island News Radio, and I am your host of The Big Picture, Karen Signoracci. And welcome back. This is The Big Picture on 103.9 Long Island News Radio. I am your host, Karen Signoracci, and today I'm talking to Jennifer Cona, and we just spent some time talking about her expertise in elder care law and her firm and the work that they do. And just that website one more time.
ConaElderLaw.com.
And now we're going to take a little bit of time, and we're going to talk about senior dreams coming true. This is a nonprofit mm-hmm. that Jennifer and her team are intricately involved in through her office and their work. And it helps seniors have their dream come true. And we're not talking on a large, large scale. We're talking about maybe visiting a loved one, maybe a special theater trip and dinner. Just something special and unique. So tell us how this started. And what I love about this is that it's tangible. You know, people can relate to this, and it's something you can touch to some extent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we started Senior Dreams Come True in 2007, and it was born of just listening to clients tell stories of friends or neighbors or sometimes themselves of simple things that would make a huge difference in their life. So it could be someone who had never seen a grandchild. They didn't have a computer or a phone, and they couldn't afford to visit them in Florida. And the grandchild was, you know, growing, was now 2 months old, and they'd never, ever seen the grandchild. And someone brought that to our attention. So we did some fundraising, and we flew that particular person down to Florida to meet her grandchild. In another case, there was someone who... when her husband died, she was not able to visit her disabled daughter in a group home upstate because he was the driver. She didn't drive. So we did some fundraising, and we got her a car service to take her to visit her daughter upstate. So very small, simple things like this, but make a huge difference in the life of that person. For someone else, we built a wheelchair ramp. We've done chairlifts. We've done dental work for someone after chemotherapy really kind of took its toll on her teeth. Refrigerators, air conditioner for someone who had MS. We rebuilt a driveway for someone who was wheelchair bound and got stuck in her house because she couldn't navigate her wheelchair on this completely destroyed driveway. So things like that. It's small one-offs. And a lot of times what we do is we will get the goods or services donated by people in the community. So that way we are really stretching our dollars. And that's been very successful. So we're engaging other community members in our efforts. And we also do a lot of hands-on work because we're a hands-on group of people in my law firm. So for someone else, her yard was completely overgrown, and she loved nothing more than to sit out back and listen to the birds and enjoy her backyard. But it was so overgrown, she couldn't get outside. So we all went over there and just did manual labor and cleaned up her yard. It took us all day one day. So we shut the office down, and we just took care of that for her. And now for the remaining years that she has, which may not be many, she'll be able to sit out back and get outside into her yard. But it's just so fulfilling for us and brings her so much joy. You know, when we talk to at the time then Senator Kemp Hannon, because he was very supportive of our program. And he said, you know, this is not something the government can do for anybody. These are small projects. The government can fill in other gaps for people, obviously, with their big programs. But these are making, these gifts, if you will, are making a difference in the lives of so many people. And they're people right in your backyard. It could be your neighbor that you don't even realize is having this difficulty. And that's what we like about it so much, that it's just someone right next to you that you may not know that is having some kind of difficulty like this, where you could reach out and make a huge difference. And that's what Senior Dreams Come True is all about.
As you started explaining Senior Dreams Come True, that list is quite long.
Hmm.
It's remarkable. And what you've been able to do since 2007.
Mm-hmm.
And it's funny because you think about it, and those might be things that we just take for granted.
Absolutely.
Take for granted that someone does come and trim our bushes, mm-hmm. or take for granted that I have the iPhone and I can FaceTime my nephew, or for an older person, their grandchild. And mm-hmm. and so that list is long. And like we said, it's tangible things, and it makes a difference.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, the other amazing part of this is, as you use the key word, you know, I wrote it down, listening. Mm-hmm. You were listening to your clients.
Yep.
As they came in, and you were listening to what was really needed. So there was a problem, and you found a solution.
Mm-hmm. It's amazing what you can learn by listening.
It is.
More people should listen more often.
We should. And you know, we always joke around. I say it to the kids sometimes too. You have to listen to comprehend, not listen with the intent to reply.
Yes, exactly.
So, okay, more business and networking tips 101 for another episode, me and you, Jennifer. But tell us a little about what someone listening right now can do, or what you might want them to know, especially about Senior Dreams Come True.
What I'd love people to know is that we are always looking to grant wishes.
Mm-hmm.
So they can go to our website and get the wish request form. The qualifications are that the person has to be over 65 years old and low income. And by low income, we mean for a single person has income of under $1,800 a month, and for a married couple under $2,500 a month. Those are the only qualifications. And then we're looking for some information about the person, a statement about what the need is and how they gave back to the community, because we'd like to help people who have also done something for their communities. Like I said, we're always looking for wishes. So go to conaelderlaw.com, go to the charitable section, you'll find Senior Dreams, and there's the wish request form. And things like I've just described, feel free to submit a wish request. And also on that same section of our website, you can donate. We're always looking for donations, of course, to support our charitable organization. It is a 501c3, and you can help us support more people in the community.
All right, terrific. So everybody has the website, so they can do that. In thinking about all of these things, Jennifer, for you, did you have a moment when you sat back, whether it was related to a legal project or the nonprofit, where you had your Oprah's calls at the aha moment, where it all clicked for you?
Yeah, I think it was, you know, we're so involved in other charitable organizations, mm-hmm. you know, whether it's Alzheimer's, or it's Island Harvest, or it's the Harry Chapin Food Bank, or you know, all those other things that we're doing to support seniors, mm-hmm. And all the issues. There's so many issues that we deal with that we thought, well, we want to do something on our own, even if it's small, that we can manage ourselves.
And that was it.
And this was it. Mm-hmm. And this was it. And it was, you know, obviously built a little bit around the Children's Make-A-Wish program.
Sure.
You know, but we said, that's such a great program, but no one's doing anything for seniors. Seniors are a little bit forgotten, I have to say. No one, it's not as sexy, quote unquote. Everybody loves to do things for children, but seniors are a bit forgotten. And that makes me really sad because, quite honestly, we all hope to be seniors because there's only one alternative to that.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to be forgotten. You probably don't want to be forgotten.
Preferably no.
So I personally, and we as a firm, really want to make life better for all of us as we age. That's a motivational factor for me personally. So anything I can do toward that, whether that is quality of care as we age, whether that's focusing on living options and situations, that's really important to me as well, or whether it's making someone's life a little bit better as he or she ages with something simple through Senior Dreams Come True, that's really important to me.
I think you bring up a very good point, and I'd love that to be a takeaway, is that there is a lot of good work being done on Long Island, but there is a population, our seniors, that are often forgotten, mm-hmm. and they need wishes, they need support, maybe they need things from the food pantry, mm-hmm. And they play a key role.
Yep.
And they've done their work, and they've done their part, and
absolutely.
Now this is our opportunity to turn it forward.
Yep, and to say thank you.
And to say thank you. So one more time for the website, Jennifer.
ConaElderLaw.com.
So Jennifer Cona, thank you for all you do. Thank you for your time today, and I hope everybody learned something. I hope you'll think about a senior that you know that maybe you can connect to Senior Dreams Come True.
Thank you so much, Karen.
This is The Big Picture on 103.9 Long Island News Radio. Thanks for listening.
The views and opinions expressed on this program are not necessarily those of this station, JVC Broadcasting Management, or